Today we will start centrifugal pump components, types of centrifugal pump now. Dear students, we are in the module 5 now, centrifugal pumps, components and types of centrifugal pumps we will be covering in this class now. So as you can know that half portion of the turbine portion of our module 5 is over. We are going to the pumps portion. So we are tackling this topic in this class now. So what is a centrifugal pump? So it is a hydraulic machine which converts the mechanical energy into hydraulic energy now. What is the mechanical energy? Most of you have seen the pumps where electrical energy will be converted into mechanical energy in terms of rotation of the shaft of the centrifugal pump now. The presence of electrical energy or the electrical energy input will be converted into mechanical energy by means of an electrical machine which rotates the shaft of the centrifugal pump. And hence the hydraulic energy will be created. That means in terms what we are saying now, it is the reverse of turbine where we convert the kinetic energy into potential energy. So what is this? Let us see it now. So here the hydraulic energy is nothing but it is the conversion of kinetic energy into pressure energy. That is nothing but the potential energy now. This is being done by means of centrifugal force. Therefore, it is called as centrifugal pump. A hydraulic machine which uses centrifugal force as the parameter for converting the kinetic energy into pressure energy is called as the centrifugal pump now. So here the principle is when a certain mass of liquid is made to rotate by an external force, it is thrown away from the through centrifugal axis of rotation and the head is impressed, which enables to rise the water to a higher level. Here the principle of the centrifugal pump. So how it is, we will be looking in the next slide now. Centrifugal pumps are most common pumps used in most of the places, maybe in agricultural area, maybe in your own houses for your rising the water from the sump to the overhead tanks in municipal area where the water is to be lifted from the lower level to the higher head tank, overhead tank in the industries. These centrifugal pumps are being used now. So here the principle is when the impeller, this is called as the impeller, when the impeller rotates the fluid surrounding it now, the fluid will be surrounding this area now. When this impeller rotates, the water surrounding it will also rotate now. The water flows radially. The water flows radially through the centrifugal force. Because of the centrifugal force, it will be thrown. It will be thrown in the radial direction now. And the pressure and kinetic energy of the water will be get increased. And this causes the mechanical energy, which is nothing but the rotation of the shaft as well as rotation of this impeller, because of the rotation of the shaft, which is the impeller is being fixed on the shaft now. A centrifugal force is created, the water is radially thrown out and the pressure energy is being increased the velocity and pressure energy will be increased. However, the main aim of this volute chamber is to increase the pressure energy and to decrease the velocity, and the water will be raised to the higher level now. So that means the main purpose of centrifugal pump is to raise the water which is at lower level to the high level now. So because when the water is being released, that means when the pressure is increased here, the water will rise in the delivery pipe and the water will be entering into the overhead tank. Because of this, a negative pressure is created in the suction pipe now. A negative pressure is created in the suction side of the impeller where water is being get displaced now. The centrifugal pump impeller, when works continuously with volute, help to create partial vacuum and low pressure. Partial vacuum and low pressure will be created when the water is being emptied from this volute chamber, and when it rises to the through the delivery pipe to the overhead tank. So here the suction pressure and low pressure is going to get converted, will be created. Therefore, the water will enter from the suction pipe towards the impeller now. This is the principle of this one. Create a partial vacuum or low pressure. When this vacuum is maintained, it helps fresh water or stream to move into the system. This is the principle of the centrifugal pump now. So this is the thing now. You can see these are the various parts of, this is the impeller portion now. This is called as the suction side and this is called as the delivery side now. So the shaft will be rotated, the shaft of this one, the shaft will be rotated. When the shaft is rotated, the impeller also rotates. The water in this impeller chamber, volute chamber, it is also volute chamber, and the suction pipe will be lifted towards the discharge side, and hence once again it empties and creates a vacuum in the suction side, and the water will start flowing from the suction side towards the delivery side. That is how the principle of the centrifugal pump is there. Now the main component of the centrifugal pump, we already telling now, the impeller, the casing, the suction pipe and the delivery pipe. These are the main components. However, the minor components which we are not discussing more now. So this is called the impeller chamber now. So you can see this is the casing now. It is a volute casing. The diameter of this one is increasing. The diameter of this one is increasing. In turbine it was decreasing. Here it is increasing now. That you should know it now. Now this is called as the impeller. This is called as the impeller now. This is called as the suction pipe. This is called as the delivery pipe. Delivery pipe will have a regulating valve. Delivery pipe will be having a regulating valve. Why it is? To regulate the water, and why it is, we will look into it now. This is a regulating valve now. And this is the vacuum gauge, because you will be having the vacuum pressure in the suction pipe, in the suction pipe. So here how the things happens, let us see now. What is the impeller? So impeller design is the most significant factor. It is the most important factor. Why it is, we will discuss it now. We will discuss in the next slides now. If it is properly designed, what is the purpose of this one? Minimize the turbulence. It minimize the turbulence. Maximize the efficiency. Maximize the efficiency means to increase the kinetic energy and the velocity energy when it goes out, when it comes out of the impeller. When it comes out of the impeller, the kinetic energy as well as the velocity energy shall be increased. The velocity, kinetic energy should increase and the pressure energy should increase. That is the purpose of the impeller. That is the center. It should generate large amount of centrifugal force and it should develop the kinetic energy as well as the pressure energy. So there are three types of impellers you can see now. One is the open impeller, semi-open impeller and closed impeller now. open impeller will be of this shape. You can see it. This is open impeller now. So open impellers are generally used for suspended solids like sieves or paper pulp like that. It is not being surrounded. What is this surrounding? We will look into it in the next slide now. Open impellers are structurally weak, just like our mixer blades, what you are seeing now. Okay, it is structurally weak now. So they are typically used for small diameter pipe. They are typically used for small diameter pumps, and they are less expensive. And these pumps are generally used for where you are having suspended solids or like sieves and paper pulp. If it is so, then we can utilize this one now. Okay, it is not being surrounded now. What is surrounding we are looking at? Here it is surrounded on. That means this open impeller is being covered on one side. That is called as the surrounding. Okay, the open impeller is covered on one side now. You can see it now. Here it is covered. There is a clear gap between the casing and the side which is being covered. The water enters here, and here the rotation happens in this direction now. Okay, so this shroud adds mechanical stability. That is important. So that means it gives mechanical strength. What will happen in this case now? This blade itself may break because of suspended solids or sieves. Therefore, it is being used for small diameter pump only. It is a small diameter pump only we are utilizing now. So the blade will get damaged. Here, damaging of the blade is being get reduced because you are having a mechanical strength. It is being covered by means of a plate. So the mechanical strength is being increased. So generally, it is being used for you are having less suspended solids, means we are using. It is a medium diameter pump. It is a medium diameter pump. So therefore, you will be having higher efficiency when compared to the open impeller. When compared to open impeller, the efficiency of this centrifugal pump is higher. Okay. So diameter of the pump is greater than the diameter of the open impeller now. Okay. So because of minimization of the recirculation and other losses, it is very important that small clearance exists between the impeller and the covering. That should be there now. So for that purpose, here you will be having a clearance will be there between the shrouding, that is the cover, as well as the casing now. Because to minimize the recirculation and other losses that may happen, friction losses, wear losses that is going to happen. So a small clearance should exist between the impeller vane and the casing. There should be a small clearance should be there now. Now, but in the case of closed impeller, you can see it now. It is covered on both sides. I think I may have a picture of all the things. You can see here now. It is open impeller now. This is a semi-open impeller or nothing but one side which is shrouded now. It is closed on both sides now. It is closed on both sides now. So in this case, what is happening here is it is closed on both sides because the strength of this one will become more. Because of that, the strength of this one will become used. Therefore, it is used for large pumps. Where the efficiency requirement is very high now. Okay, so low required net positive suction head. What it is, we will look into it now. Net positive suction head in the classes to come now. Okay, so higher efficiency will be there now. Higher mechanical strength will be there now. It is a single casting. That means it is being casted as a single. Here you will be having the wrapping will be there now. So what is that we will look into it now. So it is employed for liquid to be pumped is pure. It is a pure. There is no suspended solids will be there. So if suspended sewage is there, for example, paper pulp or suspended sewage is there now. So here the debris may sit here now. The debris may sit and it may clog. Therefore, closed impellers are not being used. Or semi-closed impeller, what we discussed, is also semi-open impellers are also not being adopted now. So here, when the water is pure, there is no chance of clogging, therefore closed impellers are used. And for very pure water drinking like municipal water or drinking water, you will be having a closed impeller now. Okay. So centrifugal pumps with closed impellers are most widely used pumps handling clear liquids now. Closed impellers are more complicated, expensive design, not only because of the impeller, but additional wear rings are required now. Here the wear rings will be there now. Wear rings will also improve our hydraulic efficiency and also the rotational efficiency. Okay. So these wear rings which are there for rotational improvement. Okay. Therefore, for that purpose, this closed ring requires the design of wear rings both outside as well as inside. The wear rings will be there now. That should be now. So it is more complicated and expensive design now. But however, nowadays it is not of a lot of improvements have happened. So most of the pumps what we are seeing are closed impeller pumps only now. Okay, this I have showed you now. Now the next is a casing now. So what is the purpose of casing now? It is an airtight passage which surrounds the impeller. This is the casing. You can see it now. This is the casing. It is the airtight passage surrounding the impeller. What is the purpose of this one? To increase the velocity, to increase whatever the water that is thrown from this now. It is having both kinetic energy as well as the pressure energy. So what is our aim now? All the kinetic energy should be minimized. Kinetic energy should be minimized means the velocity should come down. Velocity should come down. V1 should come to V2 where V2 is less than V1. So therefore only the diameter of this one is being increased. You can see the water when it flows from this end to this end. The diameter of the volute chamber is being increased in order that the velocity should come down and the pressure should increase according to our Bernoulli's principle. Now, the pressure should increase now. So the pressure energy, to increase the pressure energy, what we are having, a volute chamber will be there now, volute casing, or it is a casing now. It is a varying diameter with a smaller diameter in the beginning to a larger diameter at the exit end, which is connecting to the delivery pipe in order to increase the pressure energy. That is our say now. So it guides the water. It is, what is the purpose? It guides the water. This casing guides the water from the impeller towards the delivery side. So capable of converting the kinetic energy of the water discharging from the outlet of the impeller into pressure energy. It should be capable of, the casing should be such that it should be airtight, no leakage should be there now. At the same time, the pressure energy should increase in that chamber now. Therefore, the purpose of impeller is to increase the kinetic energy as well as pressure energy. Whereas the casing, the purpose of casing is to increase the velocity, is to convert the velocity energy into pressure energy. Velocity energy into pressure energy, or kinetic energy into pressure energy when it is flowing into delivery pipe, when it is flowing towards the delivery pipe now. So there are different types of casing now. First is the volute casing. As I have already told you, in the volute casing, you will be having a casing which is, the diameter of that one is goes on increasing now. The diameter of the casing, the diameter of the increase in the area of flow, that should be there. The area of the flows goes on increasing when it goes towards the exit. What is the purpose of this one? To decrease the velocity. The purpose of that one is to decrease the velocity and increase the pressure energy. When the velocity decreases, the pressure will increase of the liquid flows through the casing. That is our purpose now. So now, what is the aim of the casing now? I have told you, to decrease the velocity and to increase the pressure energy. So volute casing is the first one now. The second type of casing what we are seeing is nothing but the vortex casing now. In this, you will be having a circular chamber. This will be a circular chamber apart from this one now. So a vortex casing a circular chamber is introduced between the impeller and the casing. A circular chamber is placed between the impeller and the casing. This is done in order to prevent the loss of energy due to formation of eddies. So eddies are going to generate because of the water that is coming out. Lot of eddies is going to generate. To reduce the eddies and to increase the pressure energy. That is the purpose of this vertex casing now. Okay. The name itself says that one now. So the vertex casing is a circular chamber introduced between the impeller and the casing. This is done in order to prevent the loss of energy due to the formation of the eddies. Generated and to prevent the loss of energy now. The efficiency of the vertex casing is greater than the volute casing. That is, this is better than volute casing. Previous what we have discussed now. Now, better than this, what we are having is that you are having a guide here now. You are having a guide as well as the casing now. So, in the first one, increasing diameter, increasing area of the volute casing was there now. First one is increasing the area of the casing was there. In the second one, we are having a special circular casing which reduces the eddies and increases the pressure energy by means of reducing the losses. Now, third one is, apart from this one now, you will be having a guide blade. Guide blade is placed on a plate. Guide blades are mounted on a ring, which is called as the diffuser, guide blades are mounted on a ring, which is called as a diffuser. This is called as the diffuser. On the diffuser plate, you will be having the guide blade now. The design of the guide vanes. What is the purpose of guide vanes? Once again, to increase the pressure energy only. Okay. The design of the guide vanes are kept such that water which is leaving the impeller should be such that it guides without shock. There should not be any shock or there should not be any loss or eddies that is going to be developed now. Okay. The area of the guide vanes increases the area from which it is coming now. Therefore, as the area increases, what will happen? The pressure will increase. Area increases means velocity decreases. As the area increases, the velocity decreases. So from the impeller, the water is coming through the guides. Because the area increases at this point, the velocity will decrease. Velocity decreases means what? The pressure increases. Okay, so the area of the guide vanes increases. This helps to decrease the velocity of the liquid and increase the pressure. That's what I have written here. Okay, so velocity decreases means pressure increases. After the guide vanes, the water passes through the circular chamber. Circular chamber surrounding the casing now. In most of the cases, casing remains concentric with the impeller. That is, it is a circular chamber only, it will be there now. So, it is better than the previous two. First one is, I have increased the area of flow in this case, and the velocity is being decreased and the pressure is being increased. So water coming out of the impeller will have both kinetic energy as well as the pressure energy. What is our aim now? The kinetic energy, that is nothing but the velocity energy, should be decreased, velocity should be decreased and pressure should be increased. So how I did now? I have increased the area as it flows from the entry towards the exit now. So as the area increases, velocity decreases, pressure increases. This is what I have done now. That is called the volute casing. In the second casing, what I have done now? In the second casing, I have put a circle, circular chamber now. So where the eddy loss is being made to reduce and the velocity is being decreased and the pressure is being increased now. So this area is a wide area. You can see here the area of this one is very large area will be there. The velocity decreases and the pressure will decrease now. So the main purpose of this one is to reduce the eddy loss now. Okay, that is the concentric chamber now. Now in the third case, what we have done, we are having a guide plate now. So at this point, as the water comes out of the impeller, the loss because of the shock is being get reduced, and also the area is being increased. The eddies are also decreased. The area is increased. The velocity decreased, and the pressure is being increased. That's how the things we do it to the guide plate. So this is the best. This is the best amongst the three types of casing now. So this is what I have shown you now, how the casing will be there now. You just look into it, you know. So you just see vertex casing is there, volute casing, how the things are there now. So in all these cases, this is the impeller. As the water comes out of the impeller now, it passes through the circular chamber, velocity decreases and the pressure increases. Here, as the area increases, the velocity decreases, the pressure increases, and the water goes towards the delivery case. Here, it is guided through a guiding vanes, and the eddy loss is being reduced, as well as the shocks is being reduced, and the water passes through the concentric circular casing, and the velocity is decreased, and the water is being at a higher level because the pressure is increased now. So the next one is the suction pipe now. What is suction pipe? Suction pipe is on the suction side. That means the water from the sump, this is called as the sump, at which is at the lower level, to the impeller, or to the center of the centrifugal pump, is called as the suction pipe. This is called a suction pipe. This is called as the delivery pipe. Why it is called a suction pipe? Here you will be having negative pressure. Negative pressure will be there. So this suction pipe will have a higher diameter when compared to the delivery pipe, in order that more suction is getting converted now. So here the suction pipe will also have the foot wall and the strainer wall. The purpose of the strainer wall, strainer wall is to filter the foreign particle. If there is any foreign materials that is there, it should not enter into the suction pipe and damage the impeller. That is the purpose of a filter strainer will be there. The purpose of foot valve is to maintain the hydraulic pressure, negative pressure in the suction pipe, and to see that the water, as soon as the pump starts, the water starts flowing towards the delivery pipe. So we shall look into it, these things now. So the suction pipe consists of, one is the foot valve, another one is the strainer pipe. Why it is, we will look into it now. So this suction pipe is towards the inlet of the impeller to the sump or the to the lower level where the water is being get connected now. So pipe, which is one, the inlet of the impeller, and the other is dipped in the sump. Other end is dipped in the sump. It is also called as the suction pipe. The pressure is negative in this pipe, I have told you. The diameter of the suction pipe is kept larger than the diameter of the delivery pipe to increase maximum suction. That's what we told now. So diameter of the suction pipe is always greater than the diameter of the delivery pipe. At least it is equal in some cases. In most of the cases, we generally design for higher diameter pipe than compared to delivery pipe now. Suction pipe of a centrifugal pipe plays a very important role for successful and smooth working of the pump. A poorly designed suction pipe causes insufficient net positive suction at net positive suction head. This you remember it, why it is, we will look into it. What is net positive suction head? We will discuss it when we discuss the working of the centrifugal pump. So at this point, you just see that the poorly designed suction pipe causes insufficient net positive suction head. If at all, if it doesn't create proper suction, what is going to happen now? The water will not be get lifted now. So suction should be properly created. The suction head should be properly created. Sufficient suction head is to be properly created. Then only water will be lifted to the delivery pipe. That should be known to you. That is called as net positive suction head. Now, I have told you a strainer and a foot valve is connected at the bottom of suction pipe to avoid the entry of any foreign matter. Now, the strainer is used to filter the unwanted particle. Maybe some soil particles may also be there. So that will also be removed, or that will not, that will, it is seen that it will not be, it will be filtered. It will be filtered by the strainer now. Okay. And to prevent the centrifugal pump from blockage, or it may damage the impeller also now. The foot valve is basically a check valve fitted to the end of the suction pipe leading to a pump now. It is a check valve where the water can flow only in one direction. A foot valve is a valve where the water can flow even when the pump is stopped, the water will not flow in this direction. Water always flows in this direction. It will hold the water. Foot valve hold the water in the suction pipe always. A good foot valve, that is, if the foot valve is properly working, it sees that water in the delivery, water up to the delivery pipe, that means up to this point, the volute chamber and the casing, as well as the suction pipe, completely this amount always be filled up with the water only. It is only possible against the gravity, it is holding that the water will not flow through gravity passing through the foot valve. It holds, it will not allow. It is a check valve now. Water can pass only in this direction. Water can pass through the some only in this direction. Water cannot, it cannot flow from the suction side towards the sump. So that's what the foot valve will do it now. So the next one is, this one is the delivery pipe. So what is the purpose of delivery pipe? It is a pipe connecting the exit of the impeller. That means foot valve is a one-way valve. I have told you, foot valve is a one-way valve that opens in the upward direction only. It will not allow the water in the downward direction. Its purpose is to keep the fluid trapped. That means it should be there in the suction pipe of the pump and stops, thus maintaining suitable for priming of the pump. What is this priming? We will look into it now. So, priming of the pump is required before starting the pump. I think most of you may be knowing, but anyhow, we will look into it. What is priming? Priming is nothing but filling up of the water in the volute chamber, as well as in the suction chamber, suction pipe. Suction pipe is called as the priming. So before starting the pump, we should always prime the pump now. So water should always be there initially now. So when we start filling this water, the water should not flow down into the, because of gravity, into the sump. That is what it will do. It will do in the pump. So when the pump is stopped also, the water will not flow through gravity in the downward direction. It will be there. This much amount of water will be there, both in this volute chamber as well as in the suction pipe. Always, whether the pump is stopped or whether the pump is in the on condition, that is only possible by means of the foot valve. That's what I told you also now. Its purpose is to keep the fluid trapped in the suction pipe when the pump stops, thus maintaining suitable prime for the pump. Now, when the pump restarts, the suction is created, opens the valve, gives the full flow for the pump inlet now. Okay, The footwall is used to maintain hydraulic pressure. That's what I told now. So it should create hydraulic, initial hydraulic pressure for the pump to start now within the pipeline to keep the water flow in the in accordance with the given settings, means at what rate you want to discharge is required. So that is possible when the footwall is properly working. Otherwise, what will happen? The water will flow down and the water cannot be pumped from the centrifugal pump. So priming is an important topic that we will discuss in the next classes now. Okay. So delivery pipe, it is a pipe whose one end is connected to the outlet of the pump. So that means here, this I have shown you, this is called as the delivery pipe. From here, from this point to this point is called as the delivery pipe. This is called as the delivery pipe. So this delivery pipe is connected for the outlet of the pump to the other end of the other end, or the pump, the place where we want to lift the water to that height, it will be there now, where water is to be delivered now. Okay. A regulating valve is provided on the delivery pipe to regulate the supply of water. That's what we told now. So this is a regulating valve will be there. This I told you, this is the delivery, this is called as the regulating valve. This is the regulating valve. Okay, or delivery valve, we will say, whatever it may be. So how the working of the centrifugal pump is there now? So the basic function of the pump is to transfer the liquid from one place to another place with increasing pressure energy. That is what we have told now. It is not that you should lift from lower level to higher level like that. You cannot say. Sometime it may be at a very small height it may lift now. Okay. So even at the ground level, the water may have to take the water to a very lengthy, say 1 kilometer. At the same level means, yes, it is possible to pump by means of use the pump for lifting for, say, for a small height also now. So from one place to another place, if you want the water to be transferred, the main machine that we use is the pump now. The rotating impeller transmits the centrifugal force and the kinetic energy in the form of velocity of the fluid now. Okay, the pump casing volute converts the kinetic energy of liquid into pressure head. That we know it now. What is the purpose of the rotating impeller? To impart the centrifugal force, that means the kinetic energy, and the purpose of and the velocity energy. Okay, it imparts the kinetic energy, that means the velocity energy and the pressure energy will be increased because of the impeller now. Because of the volute casing, what it makes now, the purpose of the volute casing is to convert the kinetic energy into pressure energy now. Okay. So the energy occurs by two parts in the pump. One is in impeller and the one is in the casing now. It is converted in two places. The impeller is the rotating part which gives kinetic energy of the liquid, and the volute, which is the stationary part, that convert the kinetic energy into pressure energy. So that should be known to you now. So impeller mainly converts the water energy into velocity. Velocity is improved. Of course, the pressure will also improve now. Velocity energy will improve now. That is the important. So this velocity energy will be converted into pressure energy. Pressure energy in the casing or the diffuser. It is also called as the diffuser now. Okay. So now, so that means a centrifugal pump works on the principle that when certain mass of fluid is rotated by an external source, that means the here external source is nothing but what? It is the electrical energy, which makes the rotation of the shaft now. It is thrown away from the central axis of rotation, and the centrifugal head is impressed which enables to rise to higher level. This is the definition of centrifugal pump, you can say now. Okay, so to impart the centrifugal head by rotation of the water through the centrifugal force. Now I am importing centrifugal force by rotation of the impeller now, and the centrifugal head is created now. This centrifugal head is being utilized for rising the water to a higher level now. That is what the centrifugal pump works now. So important thing here is it is not that the centrifugal force only is responsible now. That should be named. If at all, if the centrifugal force is the only force, if it is creating the centrifugal head, the fin should have been radial only. Radial means completely directly like this. But what you are seeing, the fins are like this now. Centrifugal impellers are like this now. It is not radial. It is not being fixed like this now. It is not radial now. So, in practice, it is sloped tangentially. That means you are having both the force now. So, this is the radial force now. So, these are the components. That acceleration is what causes the radial flow, causes the buildup of the pressure against the volute. That should be known to you now. The volute acts as a diffuser. So the impeller is not a radial energy. It is a sloped. The impeller blades are sloped, highly sloped. It will create both radial flow as well as the tangential flow. Radial flow, that means this is the direction it goes now. The components of this one is both radial, that means in this direction, this is the radial, as well as tangential direction it is there now. If you think this at the center now, this is the radial force and this is the tangential force. So that means if the blade would have been completely radial, you should have got the force like this only. It is not like that now. That means the centrifugal force is not the only force which is creating which is responsible for improving the kinetic energy of the water now. So this will be having both radial force as well as the tangential force, but when it enters into the volute chamber will be here now, surrounding this now. So this is responsible for conversion from velocity energy to the pressure energy. Okay, that should be. That acceleration is what causes the radial flow, causes the buildup of the pressure against the volute. Buildup of the pressure against the volute is possible because of this, the impeller shape only. Okay, the volute acts as a diffuser and exchanges the velocity with pressure. That means the velocity energy will be converted into pressure energy. That is what we have told now. So centrifugal pump almost never relies solely on apparent centrifugal force. That should be known to you now. That is caused by the tangential acceleration of the fluid. If it were so, the fins would have been radial. The fins are not radial. What you see instead in practice is that fins are sloped tangentially at a high angle. What I showed you here. At a high angle. So that they impart both tangential and radial acceleration. Tangential and the radial acceleration will be developed because of this shape of the impeller blade now. So that acceleration which causes the radial flow, that means this is radial flow, causes the buildup of the pressure in the volute chamber and exchanges the velocity energy into pressure energy in the volute chamber. Okay, So that should also be a small point, should be clear to you now. It is not radial now. It is not only centrifugal force. Of course, centrifugal force is the major force, whereas we are having both radial as well as the tangential acceleration in this case now. Now stepwise working of the centrifugal pump now. So the first process is how to work, how to start the centrifugal pump now. First, the delivery valve should be closed now. That should be important now. Delivery valve is to be closed and the pump is to be primed. What is priming? Priming is nothing but filling up of the water in the suction pipe, casing and portion of delivery pipe up to the delivery valve is called as the priming. So up to here we have to fill the water now. What is that? So up to here. So up to this point, the water is to be filled now. So generally you will be having a valve here now. So that is not being shown. The water will be filled through a funnel from here now. Generally the water will be filled now. But in self-priming, as I've already told you, a foot valve will be there. It will always see that water is always there up to this point now. If foot valve is properly working now. If the foot valve is not properly working, it is leaking, means some portion of this, that means completely this is to be completely filled up with water now. Even the suction pipe is to be filled up with water. The casing, the impeller chamber and the delivery pipe. That is called as this one. So first one, the delivery valve is to be closed. Delivery valve is to be closed. Completely it should be filled up with water. That is called as the priming. That is the first step. The second step is you have to start the electric motor so that the impeller start rotating. Because the shaft rotates, the impeller starts rotating. When the impeller rotates at normal speed, then the delivery valve is to be opened. Then the suction, the water will start flowing from the impeller because the water will be thrown away. Up to here what I have told, because of the rotation, the velocity will increase. The kinetic energy will improve because of the centrifugal force as well as the tangential force. The pressure energy increases now. The pressure energy increases means the water will start flowing towards the delivery side now. Okay. So, when once the work is completed, we have to close the delivery valve. The process is to be repeated. We have to close the delivery valve. Then only the pump is to be stopped. Okay. That's what we say now. So, you just look into here now. The delivery valve is closed and the pump is primed. That means what I told, to be pumped so that no air pocket is left now. Keeping the delivery valve still closed, the electric motor is started to rotate the impeller now. The rotation of the impeller causes strong suction in the vacuum just at the eye of the casing now. The speed of the impeller is gradually increased till the impeller rotates at its normal speed and develops normal energy required for pumping the liquid now. When it becomes normal speed, after the impeller attains the normal speed, the delivery valve is opened. At that time, the delivery valve is to be opened. The liquid is completely sucked from the suction pipe and it passes through the eye of the casing and enters the impeller at its center. It enters the impeller vanes and the inlet tips. The liquid is impelled out. Impelled out means it is thrown out because of the centrifugal force of the vanes, and it comes out of the outlet. What is the process that we have already discussed now? Due to the impeller action, the pressure head as well as the velocity head of the liquid is increased. Due to the impeller action, the pressure head as well as the velocity head is increased. Some of this velocity head is converted into pressure head in the casing and in the diffuser plates and in the vanes if they are also provided now. That means the velocity energy is converted into pressure energy. From the casing, the liquid passes into the delivery pipe. It discharges from the outlet or upper end of the delivery pipe now. So long the motion is given to the impeller, that means at what time you want to stop, till then the impeller should be rotating. What time you want to work the centrifugal pump, the impeller shall be rotating. Okay. So long the motion is given to the impeller and there is supply of liquid and is lifted to the higher level and the height remains continuous now. When the pump is to be stopped, that is the important, the delivery valve should be first closed. The delivery valve should be first closed. That means, as I told, the priming should be continuous, means you have to close the delivery valve and see that up to delivery valve, the water always retains in the suction pipe as well as the casing pipe. Otherwise, the backflow is going to happen. Okay. So, and we have to stop the centrifugal pump. So that's all now. When the pump is to be stopped, delivery valve should be first closed. Otherwise, there may be some backflow from the reservoir. Delivery valve is to be closed and then you have to stop the centrifugal pump now. Okay. That is our purpose. One is self-priming is possible. Otherwise, sometimes what will happen, the water may flow from through gravity from delivery, from the overhead tank towards the sump also now. That is also possible now. So to avoid these two things, we have to close the delivery valve. Then only we have to stop the centrifugal pump now. So the next topic is, what are the different types of centrifugal pumps now? So these are all being discussed. So some portion of this one is already being discussed. However, we will look into how the classification is being done now. Based on the working head, based on the specific speed, based on the casing design, based on the number of entrances to the impeller, based on the disposition of the shaft, and based on the number of impellers, based on the type of volute, based on the relative direction of flow, based on the type of impeller. Like this, we can classify the impeller type of types of centrifugal pump into different types now. Okay, so we will look into it how the classification is being now. If the pump is to be required to pump for a height of about 15 meter, you can think now, 15 meter, say about 2 floor or 3 floors in your this one. They are all called as low head pumps now. What you use in your residential houses where 2 or 3 floors will be there, they are called as the low head pumps now. So these, in these pumps, the impellers are usually surrounded by a volute. And there will be no guide vanes. Guide vanes will not be there. I have told you what is a guide vane now. Okay. The shaft is generally horizontal. Water may enter from the impeller from one side or both side. What is this one side or both side? We will look into it. One side or both side, I will tell you when I take up in the next slide now. Depending upon the quantity of water required. If you require large quantity of water, the water may enter on both sides. What it is, you will look into it in the next slide now. Double section will be there now. Double section pipe now. It is a single section pipe or a double section pipe now. Let us look into it in the next slide now. Okay. Generally, water, it is a horizontal shaft pipe and impeller is surrounded by a volute and it is a low head pipe. That is about 15 meter now. So medium head means it is 40 meter. It can take the water up to 40 meter. Generally, guide vanes are provided. Generally, guide vanes will be there now. What is guide vanes? I have already shown you what is guide vanes in the previous slides. This is guide vanes. That should be properly noted. You should not forget. You should not forget. These are the guide blades will be there. These guide blades will be there if you want higher head, because you want to remove the eddies. You want to remove the eddies, and properly the velocity energy is to be converted to pressure energy. So if it is more than 40 meter, guide wheels will be provided. The water may enter from one side or both sides. That is, it is a single section or double section pipe, double section pump. We will look into it, what is single section and double section, in the next slides now. Anyhow, this should be known to you now. High head pumps means if it is greater than 40 meter. Generally, if the height is more than 40 meter, we will use multi-stage centrifugal pump now. So multi-stage centrifugal pump means you'll be having two or three impellers, or multi-impellers will be there now. How it will be, we will look into it in the next type of classification. Generally, multi-stage centrifugal pumps, so it is a high head pump now, because an ordinary single impeller cannot rise up to a height of 40 meter now. High head centrifugal pumps may be horizontal or vertical shaft. They may be horizontal shaft or vertical shaft, mostly used in deep wells now. Okay. Now the next type of classification is based on the specific speed. It is a technical classification now. So this is being defined. What is specific speed here? Specific speed of centrifugal pump is being defined as n root q divided by h. N root q divided by h. N is nothing but the speed of the impeller, q is the discharge, and h is the head. Okay. So it should be properly understood. So this being decided, this ns is being defined. This ns is being defined corresponding to maximum efficiency and normal working speed. Corresponding to maximum efficiency, normal working speed. This ns, the specific speed, is being defined now. So now, for a multi-stage centrifugal pump, as I've already told you, multi-stage centrifugal pump will have a more than one impeller now. For example, two impellers are there means if the head is 50 meter, if the head is to be raised is 50 meter, multi-stage centrifugal pump are being used for more than 40 meter. I have told you now. This is being told you here, 40 meter. If it is head is 50 meter, I have to take h is equal to 25 in that case. H is equal to 25. That means in a multi-stage centrifugal pump, the value of h is to be used for calculation of ns is obtained by dividing the actual head developed with the number of stages. For example, 75 meter you want to rise. You are having three stage centrifugal pump means the h is equal to 25. 75 by 3, 25 meter. H is equal to 75 divided by 3. Three stage centrifugal pump is equal to 25 divided. Okay. On the other hand, similar, the value of Q, if it is double section centrifugal pump. Double section means, I will show you. So this you remember it now. So similar, the value of Q double section pump means the actual discharge delivery should be taken half. If it is 10, you have to take it as double section means 5 you have to take. If the discharge that is designed is 10 meter cube per second means, if it is double section, you have to take it as 10 divided by 2. That is equal to 5 meter cube per second. So what is the value of this Q and H should be properly understood. Okay. Now, for slow speed, types of pumps that we use here. For slow speed radial pump, 300 to 900 specific speed now. And medium speed radial flow, 900 to 1500. High speed radial flow, 1500 to 2400. Mixed flow screw type, 2400 to 5000. And axial flow propeller type, 3400 to 15000. These are the values of NS. So what is this NS? You have to know what is the NS value, and you have to select what type of pump you have to select. That is, the slow speed radial flow pump is to be selected. Medium speed radial flow shell pump is to be selected if the specific speed is so much. It all depends on the design, what you want, what is the discharge you require, what is the head that you require now, what is the discharge you want to be pumped for your over a tank or to your, for your agricultural area, and what is the head it has to negotiate. say about 40 meter, 50 meter head, or the discharge requirement is 10 meter cube per second. You know both the things now. And you have to select whether it is low speed, high speed. It all depends on your engineering requirement. And then when you get NS, when once you get the NS, you can select the type of pump, what you want, high speed radial flow or medium speed radial pump. That when once NS is calculated, you can select what type of pump you want to this one. This is type of classification. Now the second, third type of classification, I have already defined to you now. So pump casing should be designed to minimize the losses of kinetic head as well as the head deformation. That's what our requirement. So the casing of the pump should be such that it should minimize the loss of kinetic head. That means velocity energy should not be lost, as well as the eddy loss should be minimized. And that velocity, what is being created from the centrifugal force, should be converted into pressure energy. So casing is a smooth transition of conversion from the velocity energy into pressure energy. So here the casing should be properly designed. Now efficiency of the pump largely depends upon the type of casing. That is important. If properly casing is being designed, because it is the place where the velocity energy is converted into pressure energy. You are having volute pump at vertex, and diffuser pump. These things we have already discussed in the last slides only now. So what is volute casing? I have told you now. Volute casing is a spiral-shaped casing, which is known as the volute chamber, into which impeller discharges the water with high velocity. Now, the shape of the casing is that the cross-sectional area of the flow surrounding the impeller periphery gradually increases from the tongue towards the delivery pipe. That's what we have already told you. We have already shown you that one now. Okay. So the area of that volute casing goes on increasing and the velocity is increasing. So vertex casing means that also I have told you. So simply I have, it is a subsequent, because it, we are discussing in the types, we are discussing, it is also a type of pump now. Vertex pump we say now. So it is a improvement against the simple volute casing. Here you are having a diffuser casing will be there now, where the eddies generated will be converted, eddy loss will be get reduced, and the velocity energy will be converted into pressure energy. That's what we will say now. Okay. Casing was made providing a circular chamber between the impeller and the volute chamber. We have told now the circular chamber acts as a diffuser, is known as the vertex or the whirlpool chamber, and as such pump is also called as the volute pump or called as the vertex pump. Almost all volute pumps are single stage type and horizontal shaft irrespective of the shape. So they are horizontal shape, single stage pump. That means you will be having a single impeller now. Diffuser pump now. Diffuser pump is third one. You will be having the guide vanes now. Okay. So guide vanes will be there. A series of guide vanes will be there now. Okay. They are mounted on a ring called a diffuser ring. This we have discussed now. Diffuser pumps are also known as the turbine pump. That should be properly understood now. Diffuser pump is also called as the turbine pump. Diffuser pumps may be either horizontal or vertical shaft. However, the vertex pumps are all horizontal. Previous one, volute as well as vertex, are horizontal shaft, whereas this one may be vertical or horizontal shaft now. Now, single section pump as well as the double section pump. This also I have told you now. Single section pump, as I told you now, you will be having a single section. That means the water enters from one end. The water enter from one end, and you will be having the water will be passing through the impeller, and it flows radially. It flows radially like this now. Whereas in double section, the water enters from both sides now. You can see it now. The water enters from both sides. You are having two inlets now. Two inlets. So here the impeller will be at the center now. Whenever you require higher energy, whenever you require higher discharge, you will be having double impeller now, double section. Now that water will enter double suction pipes, so that the water will enter from both sides, and hence the water quantity will be more. The impeller rotation happens now, and the water will be lifted. Here you just see now, so the water is entering on both sides. Here the water is entering from only one side now. You can see in this picture also, it is only one inlet is there. Here you will be having double inlet will be there. There only, that's what I told now in the calculation of NS. Here it may become double the discharge. Q is equal to Q1 plus Q2. Here Q is equal to Q1 only. Q1 plus Q1, that is equal to 2Q1, it will be there now. Therefore, we have to divide it by 2 when we are using NS is equal to N root Q divided by H. That's where we want to use the value of Q. The value of Q should be equal to Q by 2 when you are having double suction pipe in this case now. Okay. So, double suction pipe, single suction pipe means here, single suction means name signifies one-sided suction impeller now. In this pump, liquid enters the impeller through one suction pipe only. It has a single suction impeller. This pump can have higher axial thrust due to imbalance of flow coming from only one side. So you'll be having higher axial thrust because from only one side the water is entering into the pump now. Whereas in the case of double suction pump, which is being used for very high flow when the flow required is very high, and a single suction pump cannot be fulfilled the requirement now. In this case, the liquid impeller enters the impeller through both the side of the impeller and increases the flow now. In double suction pumps, total flow rate is distributed over several impellers arranged on the pump shaft now. The head remains constant. In both the cases, the head remains constant. In that case also head remains constant. In the second case also head remains constant. The impeller pairs are arranged back to back. You can see the impellers are arranged back to back, and the pump on the pump shaft and the double suction pipe. That means here the impellers are being kept back to back. You may have double impeller means you may have one more impeller here. The water may flow from this side. I am showing only one impeller. You may have double impeller. If you have two-stage centrifugal pump, you may have one more impeller here now. The water may enter from this side as well as from this side. That should be understood now. Now, so according to the disposition of the shaft, how the shaft is there now? One is the horizontal centrifugal pump as well as the vertical centrifugal. If the shaft is horizontal centrifugal pump. If the shaft is vertical centrifugal pump. Normally, centrifugal pumps are designed for horizontal shaft, and the impellers are mounted vertically. You can see here now, this is the horizontal shaft. The impeller is there in this chamber now. Impellers are there in this chamber now. This is the vertical shaft. Here the impellers are arranged like this now. You may have 3 or 4 impellers also if it is a multi-stage centrifugal pump. If it is a single-stage centrifugal pump, only one impeller will be there. Here there is only one impeller. It is placed, this is the volute chamber. The only one impeller will be there inside now. Okay. So normally horizontal shafts are being designed because they are stable now. Okay. Impellers are mounted vertically on the shaft. They are most commonly used for irrigation. All the pumps are used for irrigation as well as for water supply. So even the vertical shafts are also used for irrigation only now. Vertical disposition shafts, because why it is the less space, it requires less space. Okay, and hence vertical pumps are being suitable for deep wells as well as mines, where space is the main requirement, where is the space constraint is there, then we will use for vertical pumps now. They can be used for irrigation purpose now. So here the impellers are mounted horizontally. Because it is a vertical shaft, the impellers are mounted horizontally. In the other case, horizontal shaft vertically. In this case, vertical shaft horizontally. The impellers are kept horizontally now. Okay. Vertical disposition shafts provides economy in space, and hence vertical pumps are suitable for deep well pumps now. Okay. and irrigation purpose. One more type of vertical centrifugal pumps are either submerged or exposed. They may be submerged or it may be over the ground also. The body of an exposed vertical centrifugal pumps is usually set in the sump. That should be known to you now. The body of an exposed centrifugal pump is usually set in a sump at a level that can accommodate the suction lift. That should be known to you now. It will be kept in the sump only at a level that can upon, that means suction lift should be there now. Suction pipe accommodation should also be there. Then it can be kept in the sump only. It can be kept in the sump only. Maybe you can say that even in deep well pumps, deep well, open well pumps, you may have vertical pumps maybe placed now. Okay. Now, centrifugal pump based on the type of impeller. Now, this also I have told you now, closed impeller, semi-open impeller and open impeller. This is also being discussed where it is to be used. This is being used for sea ways as well as the pulp industries. This is being closed impellers are being used for pure water. This is being used for less pure water. Medium head now. You will be having only one-sided shrouding will be there. Here both sides shrouding will be there. It is covered, impellers will be there. It is open and it is being used for sewerage pumping. It is a small diameter, medium diameter and high diameter pump now. This is a small diameter pump. This is a medium diameter pump. This is a high diameter pump now. This is we have discussed already now. Now the next one is types based on the number of impellers. I have already told you this one. Single stage means one impeller will be there. Multi stage means several impellers will be there. Double stage means two impellers will be there. So impellers will be there on a shaft now. Okay. So single stage centrifugal pin, single impeller. The pump is having simplest design. Maintenance is very easy. Suitable for low pressure, low flow rate. Most of our 2 to 3 flows pumping means you will be having single stage centrifugal pump now. When the height is to be more than 50 or 60 meter, you may use double impeller or two stage pumps will be used in these pumps. So they are accorded the medium head application. These will have two stage pumps are widely used for apartments where 50 to 60 meter is to be pumped now. Multi stage centrifugal pumps where it is very deep. If the water is available, say about 1000 meter below, then you may have to rise it to 1200, 1300, means then you might use the multi-stage centrifugal pump now. So they will be having more than 3 impellers now, 8 stages, 10 stages we will say now, that means 8 or 10 impellers will be used, mainly used for high head services now. In case many impellers are connected in series to be get required for higher head. In this case, many impellers are connected in series to get required head. How it is, you just look into here. So here you can see here, this is single stage. This is a double stage, you are having two impellers now. And here you can see how many impellers are there now, multi-stage. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 impellers are there. This is a 4-stage centrifugal pump. 1, 2. I think it is 4, 1, 2, 3 and 4. 4 impellers are there. It is 4 impellers, 4 stage. You may have many stages also, 8 or 10 stage centrifugal pump. Generally, agricultural pumps will be having 8 to 10 stage centrifugal pumps also, where you may have to rise for a higher level now. Next is single volute and double volute centrifugal pump now. This kind of pump is having only one volute. Okay, I have shown you what is volute, we have told now. This is, we have already shown. This is one volute where the diameter is goes on increasing. This is a single volute. You can see here, this is single volute. The diameter goes on increasing. This is what thing. Double volute means what? At 180 degree, you may have one more this one. You may have one more volute now. This is one volute. This is one volute and this is another volute. you can see two volutes are there. At 180 degree, you are having one more volute, double volute pump. So you will be having cut water, two cut waters will be there now. Okay, so this is one volute and this is one more volute. You can see here the diameter of this one is less here. Diameter is increasing as it goes to this point. Here you can see here, diameter of this one is less now. Diameter is increasing here. So the water from here, it flows like this. The water from here, it flows like this now. From this point, the water flows in this manner. So it is a double volute pump. Okay. So only one, right? Low capacity pumps will have one volute now. Okay. If the space is very small and the capacity requirement is less, then single volute will be having higher unbalancing radial load because it is acting on only one direction now. Whereas in the double volute, you will be having two partial volutes. As I told you, here you will be having two partial volutes now. So what I am showing you here now, two partial volutes will be there. So what it is, just look into here now. One volute will act, will flow the water in this direction. It flows the water in this direction. Another volute, which is in this direction now. It flows water in this direction. The water flows in this direction. So it is a balance. There will be a balance. Okay. So here unbalance will be there in the single volute now. So two partial volutes will be there now at 180 degrees apart now. Both these volutes are located in the volute chamber only, same volute chamber. Due to 180 degree angles, the pumps are balanced radial load will be there now. Double volute centrifugal pumps are widely used in many industries. Okay. So it will be having a double volute chamber. That is the difference. We already know what is volute chamber. Volute is we are increasing the diameter and hence the pressure is being decreased. Velocity increments, pressure decrement. Of course, this is the case in these scales also now. Here it is acting in two places. One is in this place, and the one is in this space. So the velocity decrement is happening, a balanced velocity decrement and the pressure increment is happening. So it is double. This is being used for industrial pumps. They are being used for industrial pumps. Industrial pumps now. Okay. Now the next one is based on the relative direction of flow now. One is radial flow, another one is axial flow, another one is a mixed flow now. Radial flow is already being known to you now. Water flows from the center, it passes through the center. So in this case, what will happen? The water flows from the center. This is the radial flow now. The water flows to the center now. The rotation happens now. The flow will happen in this place now. The radially the water will flow in this direction. This is called as the radial flow centrifugal pump now. Okay. So the water comes to the axial, to the center of the eye from the suction pipe and water flows radially. Whereas in the case of axial pump, as you can see now, here the water flows axially and flows like this one. This is axial flow. Here the head is generated because of the propulsion only. Head is propelling or lift of the wheels now. So this is what we are looking into now. So just look into here now. In this, the liquid flow through the impeller in the radial direction, I have told you now, the radial flow pump, the liquid enters at the center of the impeller and is directed out along the impeller blades in the direction right angle to the pump shaft. That's what you should see. Right angle to the pump shaft, it will move. This is a pump shaft, it is moving at right angle and the rotation, and through the volute chamber, it is flowing back now. Eddies developed by the action of centrifugal force, this we discussed in detail, on the way of the liquid. Generally, centrifugal pumps are manufactured with radial flow impellers only. Very rarely axial flow centrifugal pumps are being used. Where the water availability at low head water availability is there and high discharge is required, then you require the axial flow pump now. So axial flow pumps are designed for large quantities of water at relatively low head. You require large quantity. Q required is large. Large discharge is required. Whereas head availability is low. Low head. Say for example, 8 to 10 meter is to be lifted. 8 to 10 meter is to be lifted. Very large quantity of water. Then axial flow type of centrifugal pump. Here you can see the water comes from here. The water comes from here. The propulsion happens here and the water goes. This figure is quite clear now. The water comes here and the propulsion happens and the water flows in the axial direction only now. So what is that? Head is developed to propelling or lift action of the vane on the liquid, similar to aeroplane. This is very important point here. Head is developed by propelling or lift action only. So axial pumps are used because when you require large quantities of water at relatively low head. Just see here the radial head, what we are looking at. Head developed by the action of the centrifugal force on the vane. So when you require for a larger head, low discharge is required, then radial flow is required. So for medium head, you can go for mixed type. Mixed type means you can see here the blade is in this pattern. The water flows axially. And comes out radially. In this type of liquid flows to the flows through the impeller axially as well as radially. That is, there is combination of radial flow as well as the axial flow will be there now. Head develop is partly by the action of propulsion, partly by action of centrifugal force. Both the things are there. In the axial pumps, what you are having? Only because of the propulsion. In radial pump, what you are having? Only because of the centrifugal force. Whereas it is a mixed flow turbines, mixed flow pumps, where the centrifugal force is developed because of the radial blades that are there. No? Because of the propulsion also, you are having axial, the pressure is being get developed now. So mixed flow impellers are just modification of the radial flow type, enabling pump to pump for a larger quantity of water. Axial pumps are used for large quantity. So here mixed pumps are also used for large quantity of water. Okay. As such, mixed pumps are generally used for where large quantity of flow is required to be discharged at low head. That is important. Head, once again, head is low, then mixed flow pumps are now. So that is about the types of classification, the components of centrifugal pump, the working of the centrifugal pump. So in the next class, we shall go to the work done and efficiency of the centrifugal pump, the mathematical part of the centrifugal pump chapter. Thank you for today. These are the mixed flow pumps you can see here now. The water flows like this now and enters. This is the radial flow. This is the axial flow schematic diagram. This is the axial flow, the water enters like this. Now, this is the mixed flow. Okay. Yes, we will stop today for this. Thank you.